back to Shikha, I think you know that we were all on that bus ride on day one. Not day one, but when we actually announced. And this was one of the best things that could have happened to the city. And obviously, we want more of this. So what are the plans, Shikha, of using this time in COVID to increase the number of bus priority lanes in the city into many of the high density corridors? Is there some work going on? And when will that be ready? And what are the challenges that you faced? And how do you think we can move on this whole concept of bus priority lane significantly?
Yes, bus priority lane is one of the very good things that could happen to BMTC as well as to the people in Bangalore. We have seen substantial reduction in time taken to travel. That's a pilot stretch, which is between Central Silk Board and up to KR Puram crossing in the ORR road. And there has been also an increase in ridership in that area. And based on the outcomes of the pilot, government has already announced these bus priority lanes in 12 other high density corridors. So this was also announced in this budget. For that already, along with Dalt, we have started the drawings and sketch for the three other corridors. And it would be great because the time reduction is, there's reduction in travel time, obviously people will prefer to take the bus, especially in this high density corridors. And simultaneously, these choke points can be also easily eased out. So this was again a multi-departmental approach in which we needed the help of Metro, Dalt, Bangalore Traffic Police, BBMP, and all these departments have come together. And the newer ones, the other 12 ones, would be implemented by KRDCL. So these 12 high-density corridors have been planned to be handed over from BBMP to KRDCL, and KRDCL will be the nodal single agency which will be taking care of these 12 high density corridors.
And when do you think those would be ready? Any idea? What is the target date for operation?
Okay, so the prior target was this financial year, but as I said again, COVID has changed a lot of dates and a lot of programs. But we have started the work on these three corridors. So I think shortly it should come through, and KRDCL is the nodal agency, so that it makes it easier to coordinate with a single agency.
Right, because I think we must use this time of lockdown to make all these changes, because infrastructure changes at this time would be much easier. When things are better, the infrastructure would have caught up with it. So hopefully we will see all the 12 bus corridors coming online. I think with that we are at 7:30 and we want to take a few questions. Shaheen, you had some last comments to make. If you can make it very quickly, please.
I just wanted to say a couple of things. One, the route, we need some kind of a comprehensive route planning which better reflects the needs, because, many dormant needs in the, particularly in the working class communities and, interior areas, etc., probably not getting mapped. If we can do that kind of an exercise, again, at a time like this, it really gives us a foundation to build further when we are, able to provide better services. So some kind of a route planning and need assessment, particularly extending to communities which are more vulnerable, and, tapping the needs from there and capturing that and planning the services around that. That, I think, is one thing that we would, want to stress on. The other two things that I wanted to say is, we have to recognize the fact that bus is going to be the central mode, irrespective of all other modes that we have. I mean, whether we have metro, whether we have suburban, etc. Bus gives a lot of flexibility, versatility, and COVID, in fact, you know, has brought that out. You know, it's only because, you know, we had bus that we could offer that mobility to citizens. I mean, a service like metro cannot run during a pandemic because it's an air-conditioned, you know, circulating kind of a mechanism in which, you know, it is, the spread is, there is, the risk is greater. But with BMTC, you know, that risk can be contained much better than in, say, a metro. Even a route redeployment is much easier when it comes to bus. So bus is a much more lasting and, you know, flexible public transport solution, and a lot of people will continue to use that. So I think the what we want to say is that, you know, investing in bus and recognizing the centrality of bus, again, this is you know, an opportunity for us to reimagine transport with bus having that central role in public transport. And the third thing I wanted to say is that, you know, economic packages, when we look at whether it is the COVID specific economic packages that are being planned or even otherwise, we should see transport as a socio-economic infrastructure of the city, and enabling that through multiple ways of investing in buses, you know, whether it is more buses, more staff to run those buses, better public transport infrastructure, all of these, you know, last mile connectivity, all of these, you know, need investment. And whether it is a state government or the central government, I think there is a need to plan for greater funding for buses. All this while, public transport funding has gone to metro more than buses. So probably, you know, now is the time to even financially prioritize buses and BMTC. So these are the things that we wanted to say.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. I think with that, we will... We will now take up some questions. I think, will somebody read out some of the key questions that have come up so that we can take them up?
Shonali? Yes. Thank you to everyone who sent in questions. Our first question is for Ms. Shikha. It was about the integration of mobility services through a single app and the possibility of enabling buses with GPS so that we can have an app for real-time tracking of buses. So if you could just talk about the possibility of that happening.
So the app was very much there. The My BMTC app was there, and I think around 1 lakh odd people had downloaded it also. But the only thing is, it was also GPS-based, where one could know the real-time arrival and time, estimated time of arrival of a bus. But due to the rescheduling of buses post COVID, we have the app is no more useful. But obviously, soon we would be, once the normalcy returns and the routes are frozen, we would again be initiating it. And a better app is also in pipeline, and under Nirbhaya scheme, we are planning to install fresh sets of VTUs for all the vehicles and come up with a better version of the app, in which even the integration with other services, including metro, cycles, bicycle sharing, ULU integration will also be there.
All right, thank you. Our next question is for Ms. Sonal Kulkarni. If you could please just give us your opinion on the possibility of opening bus lanes to cyclists only, just as a safety precaution, because it is a dangerous, it is quite dangerous otherwise. The possibility of opening it up just to cyclists?
Is that during the pandemic when the bus frequency is less, or in general? The question, I mean, I just want to clarify that question.
I think it's in general, but considering now that traffic is less, it may make more sense looking at it once lockdown is completely
open. I think it's definitely possible. London does this. Where they allow the cyclists to use the bus lane, but there needs to be safety precautions that need to be taken up. So we need to train the bus drivers and also the cyclists to not be aggressive on this lane if they're going to take this lane. And yeah, it's possible.
Thank you. We have one more question for you, and it's about the location of bus stands. So how are the bus stand locations decided, and when was the last alignment of bus stands made in Bangalore?
So basically, bus stand has to be present at every 500 meters because that the density of bus stands is depending on, like, you know, so it also depends on the road networks and the where the bus plies. But generally, a distance between one bus stand and another should be not less than 500 meters. So that's how you design bus shelters or bus stands. And what was the other part of the question?
When was the last alignment of bus stands made in Bangalore?
I am not sure, actually. Maybe ma'am can take the question.
Yes, I'll just like to chip in here. Sonal is right. Ideally, it is 500. The distance between two bus stands is 500 meters. It is inquired into and looked upon by BBMP. They take the public opinion also into consideration, the traffic pattern also into consideration before deciding on a bus stand. And this, when was last reorientation done? It's a very dynamic procedure because we have seen new bus stands come up in recent times. So I don't think there is a one-time activity of orientation of bus stands. It's a dynamic activity which keeps on happening. And any such request from public can come directly to either BMTC or BBMP. We can take it up.
Thank you. As a follow-up question to this, with changes in road alignments like conversion of two ways into one way, road repairs, tree felling, metro construction and so on, how effective are present bus stand locations?
So as I said, once a metro comes up, obviously the bus stands also change. So we are seeing that latest wherever the, for example, in Banshankari route where Yelchanhalli was the last stop and now the metro is extending further. So in such cases where new roads are converging, new stops or stations are coming up, it's a dynamic procedure and the departments in consultation with each other and in consultation with public, they keep changing the orientation and placement of bus stops. And coming back to that question on cycle, so I don't think right now we are ready for having cycle movement on the bus lanes itself, because we have been doing it on a pilot basis. So it is better let buses stabilize first, and then we may have, because right now what the space has given to bus is just enough for the bus to squeeze in. So I don't know whether it will be safe for cyclists to move on that. There are a lot of queries on financial situation on of BMTC. Would you like to take it up?
Yes, we will come to that, ma'am. Just move a question on bus lanes. How do you plan to expand the roads to accommodate bus lanes considering the already small width of the main roads in the city?
So ideally, bus lanes are coming up only where there are already three lanes available. So one lane is exclusively earmarked for buses and then two lanes are left out for the remaining traffic. And where there are two lanes, there we would not talk about a static bus lane or a permanent bus lane. It would be more of a pop-up bus lane where only during peak time the bus lanes would be there. Otherwise, it would be a mixed traffic. So this is the policy which state government is following as of now.
And actually, just to add to that, world over, a bus priority lane generally does not have bollards. But looking at the traffic behaviors in India, I think we went with the bollards. But generally, a bus priority lanes just means that it's just earmarked and painted and marked, like the line marking is done. But generally, no bollards are placed if you see world over. Lane width will not matter, is what I'm trying to say. It's the priority given to the buses.
I see some people are raising their hands. We are restricting the questions only to the chat box. So just request everybody to put their messages into the chat box and we will pick it up. Shikha, if you could take up this question on financials, which is coming repeatedly, that would be good.
Okay, so these questions have been asked by four viewers and a very valid point where people are saying BMTC is a loss-making entity. Yes, we agree. City buses can never be a profit-making entity and we are not even doing it for profit. And because it is not feasible to make it a profitable business, our aim is to provide maximum coverage. And in that, we would require assistance from both state and central government. As you know, in this COVID time, the state government has assisted us by virtue of paying the salaries of our staff for last 4 months. And this time also, this month also, there was one query on delay in salary payment. So it is at least to us now. And not just this month, for next 4 months also, government has taken care of. So these are some of the things. But when I talk about assistance, it would include two, three things. One, direct assistance from the government. Second would be disincentive to go for private transport. It could be by way of taxes. It could be by way of petrol cess or diesel cess, which we had done for metro, where every liter of the petrol, diesel, one bought, 1 rupee went to metro. So those kind of cross-subsidizing and cess mechanism. Or there could also be, like in BMLTA, what we are working on is the particular taxes and cess collection comes directly to the mobility sector, especially if it's a public transport, based on the FAR, based on the conversion, based on the kind of property which is coming up. So these are some of the mechanisms which one has to seriously pursue. And in that thing, BMLTA would be a great help, because that takes into consideration all of these. And there are some of the learning experiences from London Transport for All. And there also similar kind of incentives and disincentives were made. And also parking, we should make parking, like right now we are seeing that people have taken parking on road for granted. And we should levy some kind of parking fees on that, so that that would also act as a disincentive for people to bring out their private vehicle.
Shikha, I'm glad you mentioned about parking, because we have given detailed recommendations. BPAC has given very detailed recommendations to on the parking policy, which was recently announced, which actually incentivizes people to use their private vehicles. And we have said, create a hierarchy of parking charges based on whether it is supporting first and last mile connectivity, and higher to EV vehicles and higher to shared mobility, rather than and with wherever it is connecting up to public transport. So unless we do these kinds of things, public parking policy cannot be viewed independent of public transport. It has to be an enabler for public transport. So if we make it more convenient for people to use private transport, then they will start using it. So these are the kinds of things that the people have to think through, and maybe we'll have another discussion. But these are things that we have already proposed to DALT when they put out their policy, and I hope they're going to take this up seriously and look at the hierarchy, both in terms of making parking available with a preference to shared mobility and EV rather than to private, so that it encourages people to provide that to encourage first and last mile connectivity. So I think we are running out of time, and unless we have any pressing questions, I'd like to close. Sonali, can we close this? Unless we have very, very pressing.
Yes,
points.
Just one last question to Ms. Shaheen Shasa. If you could just give us a brief idea about what you mean by the right to mobility.
The way typically mobility is being talked about is as a use, sort of a consumer and a provider kind of a relationship. But I mean, when you frame it as a right, the framing becomes very different. I mean, you look at it from a different perspective. You're providing access to city for various fundamental rights to be realized. So that's why we would like to frame the issue as right to mobility rather than as a service being provided, and as a consumer accessing a service, but more as a citizen accessing a right. I mean, that's how we want to frame it, because mobility in a city enables many other rights, whether it is right to education, right to livelihood, right to health. All of this can be realized for everyone equitably only if we have a equitable, mobility access for everyone. So that's the framing that we are talking about.
Yeah. Thanks, Shaheen. I think with that, any closing comments, Shikha, from your side? Shikha, do you want to leave the audience with any last thoughts? Because bus is the most emotional issue for the city right now.
Yes. This has been a very discussion, and many points have come out, including one very relevant point in the Supreme Court of Question, that this pandemic has shown that buses are the only way out during pandemic, because other modes of public transport could take off. So keeping that in, to ensure that how to strengthen the PMTC organization. It has been even worldwide, or if we compare it with other cities in India, I don't think cities in India post-COVID carried 13 lakh passengers without causing any kind of inconvenience to people. and without any kind of much hazard. And we to keep it up, it is very important that BMTC is strengthened, and we have a very strong team at BMTC here, and we would look forward to extending our services further.
Shikha, really kind of you. We are so thrilled to have you leading BMTC. You've been always available to each one of us, and really thank you for that. If you can please somehow, I'll ask Rajiv to make some closing remarks, but in the meanwhile, at least you can adjust your camera to for us, for the audience to see you. That will be great. We'll take one last picture if we can on a gallery view. And it was really a thank you for all your support. Anyway, over to you, Rajiv.
Well, Shikha's camera may be having a different orientation, but her commitment and BMTC's orientation towards moving Bangaloreans safely and has been very much on the mark. And I think I want to thank each and every one of you. Thank you, Revati, for orchestrating this very, really engaging discussion. We've covered so many different facets. And Sonal has brought in the planning perspective. Shaheen has emphasized how we need to think about public transport essentially as a right. And that, of course, makes us and generally the entire theme and the questions, the audience engagement, everything shows us that public transport, buses especially, are a very central priority for people from Bengaluru and I think everywhere. And this is something that should really bring in a paradigm shift in the way the government prioritizes buses and funding for BMTC and other transport corporations. And I'm so happy to hear that, construction workers, garment workers, et cetera, senior citizens, all of them are being given free transportation. We have to ensure that, transportation is accessible and available to especially the more disadvantaged and vulnerable of our fellow citizens. I think this discussion is going to take us in that direction. And I know this Bengaluru Moving, this summit series that we've been having has generated a range of very interesting suggestions and points. We're going to compile them all together and engage with senior policymakers, representatives. And I think this will all cumulatively have an impact on improving transportation options for all of us in this city. And it's been fascinating. Thank you, Revati. Thank you, Shikha. Thank you, Shaheen. Thank you, Sonal and Shonali as well.